Hello and welcome to video lecture in Sociology. Today we are going to discuss Chapter 5 titled as Change and Development in Industrial Society from your textbook Social Change and Development in India. This chapter is divided into four parts. So far, we have discussed about the nature, features and emergence of industrial societies. We have also discussed about industrialization and economic development and various sectors of economy. We have also discussed something about specificity of industrialization in India. Today, we will discuss about work and finding employment, or how do people find jobs. Understanding of work requires an understanding of the economic structure or systems within which the work takes place. Over the years, the nature of work has changed drastically. It is because the social and economic changes brought about by the Industrial Revolution were massive. These changes have continued in the last 100 years as a result of technological innovations in the process of production and changes in the nature of organizations all over the world. But defining work is not as straightforward as we think. The sociology of work has traditionally focused on wage labor or paid employment. However, there are people engaged in work outside formal economies also, what sociologists call as informal economy. According to Rafael and Jonathan Gershney, one can identify three different economies in which people work. These are: the first one is the formal economy. This is official economy recognized by the government, and it is based on the paid employment. Such work is regulated, it is subjected to various laws and various acts. The workers in this sector are secure. The second is the informal economy. This includes people who work off the record book to avoid taxation and fulfilling other statutory requirements prescribed by the government from time to time. The work is not fixed here, and workers in this sector are not secure because of lack of these regulations. The third is the household economy. This involves the work done within the household by the members to provide services for themselves and to other members in the family. It is described as domestic labor. Much of this work is done by women, such as cooking, cleaning, caring for children, sick and old people in the family, and taking care of the cattle and farmland. You must be knowing that women who are primarily doing household tasks and do not take up employment outside, they are called as housewives. Apart from formal, informal and household economies, yet another type of economy of work described by Ray and Jonathan is communal economy. This involves unpaid work outside the household, like voluntary work for church or charity, or unpaid work for a political party or trade unions. Work in various sectors of economy is carried out in organizations. In fact, organizations are important part of industrial societies to carry out work systematically and smoothly. One particular form of organization is called as bureaucracy. Bureaucracy is an inevitable feature of organizations in industrial societies. According to Max Weber, bureaucratic organizations have a dominant influence in the industrial societies. There is an increasing bureaucratization of civil services, armed forces, educational institutions, hospitals, manufacturing companies, and even religious institutions. But what is meant by bureaucracy? What are its features? Let us discuss some of these features as put forward by Max Weber. The first important feature of a bureaucracy is specialization. In a bureaucracy, official tasks and positions are clearly demarcated, each covering a distinct and specific area of competence. Bureaucratic organizations are usually divided into departments with specific responsibilities, and each official has a specific role within the department. The second important feature of a bureaucracy is hierarchy. There is a series of ranks or levels of authority in a vertical hierarchy, and each official is accountable to and is supervised by one above in the rank in the hierarchy. The third feature is about the rules. There are clearly established set of rules which govern the management of the organization or bureaucracy. Persons working in the organizations have to refer to these rules and follow the procedures while taking any decisions or functioning. They simply cannot function according to their own choice. The fourth important feature of a bureaucracy is eligibility. Officials in a bureaucracy are selected and appointed on the basis of technical qualifications or on the basis of a formal criteria laid down very clearly. One person is appointed for one post. That particular post remains the main occupation of the individual for which the person is primarily accountable. The individual is also subject to formal career structure with a system of promotion according to seniority, competence, merit, or on the basis of any objective criteria of promotion decided by the organization from time to time. Impersonality is the next important feature of a bureaucracy. Everyone within the organization is subject to same set of formal rules that are impersonal in nature, that is, they apply to all equally, irrespective of any socio-cultural, official or political affiliation. The last feature that we'll discuss is public-private distinction. There is a clear-cut separation between official activity and personal life of the individual. For example, money handled by an official at the work is kept separate from his private money or income. Modern organizations, along with many structural, institutional and cultural changes, were introduced by the British during the colonial times in India. These changes continued after the British left. Immediately after independence, the government sought for planned development, focusing upon both the agrarian reform and industrialization. A lot of changes also happened in the nature of social relations in rural areas, especially in those regions that underwent green revolution with commercialization of agriculture. The prevailing conditions in the agricultural sector, growth of industries in urban and commercial areas, development of means of transportation, communication, and many such factors together led to massive migration of people from rural to urban areas. In sum, growth of economy opened up doors for job seekers in various sectors, mainly secondary and tertiary sectors in urban areas and organized and unorganized sectors. We have already discussed the differences between these sectors of economy in terms of their approach, ownership, management, and nature of relationship between workers and the management. Functioning of an economy rests upon people or workers who contribute to the economy. How do we define a worker? A worker is an individual engaged in productive activity and who contributes to the GDP by rendering his services. At this stage, one may ask that how do people find jobs? How the job market functions or operates? Let us try exploring some of these issues pertaining to finding jobs or employment. There are many aspects associated with doing a job or finding an employment. Employment essentially involves a job seeker, that is an employee, and a job giver, the employer. You must have seen that almost all the major daily newspapers come up with weekly supplements in which various jobs are advertised regularly. You will also find that there are strategies or steps given about how to motivate yourself or your workers to perform job better. For a job seeker, there are many issues, such as finding a job, applying for a job, suitable qualification, eligibility, salary criteria, actually doing a job or being on the job, finding satisfaction from what you do or job satisfaction and promotion, etc. In contrast, for an employer, the issues are related to offering wages, maintaining discipline among workers, finding right level of skill to perform job, avoid conflict within and in between workers, and earn their loyalty. Broadly, workers can be divided into four categories. The first is the regular worker. Regular workers are on the permanent rolls and enjoy many social security benefits, for example, government employees or state government employees. The second category is of the hired workers. They are hired by people or companies. These workers are paid wages on monthly basis, for example, workers working in secondary sector or manufacturing industries. The third category is of the casual workers. Casual workers are temporary workers paid on daily basis. They are daily wage earners. They are not given any social security benefit, such as construction labor or workers in small-scale industries. The last category is of self-employed people. These are the people engaged in their own business or practicing a profession. Their profit is their earning, such as doctors, lawyers, chartered accountants, or businessmen. In fact, employment involves many variables. Some of these are qualifications or educational level of an individual, skill, eligibility, experience on job, working conditions, appropriate wages, styles and practices of management, etc. The combination and presence of these factors and many more variables is also dependent upon the sector in which a person is employed, like primary, secondary, tertiary sector, public or private sector, or organized or unorganized sector. Let us briefly look at the difference between doing jobs in the government sector and private sector. Both the private sector and government sector jobs have comparative advantages and disadvantages. They can be compared on the basis of job security, pay structure, chances of promotion, working hours, retirement benefits, pension scheme, structure of leave, and other such benefits. Let us discuss job security. It is one of the major issues in private sector as it is subject to layoffs depending upon the uncertainty of market conditions. This uncertainty was witnessed during the time of economic recession world over. Government sector, on the contrary, offers job security as it is not contingent upon the market forces or profit margins. The jobs in private sectors offer different kind of incentives and post a different set of challenges for the job seekers. Like if you take up employment in a well-known hotel or in a real estate company, it is also regular salaried employment, but here the salary and qualification required are flexible and the job is likely to be on contract. The work culture, environment, job security, certainty, promotion avenues are different in private sector. Depending upon the nature of work and type of industry, private sector may offer very good pay packages, including very attractive incentives and perks. The workers in the private sector work towards achieving targets. They work overtime and at times even on holidays. But they are not paid overtime benefits which they are entitled to. Whereas the government sector has standard working hours, it has fixed pay salaries which are revised from time to time, a fixed holiday structure, and all these rules are rigidly followed in government organizations. The total number of regular civilian employees, excluding the defense personnel, in central government establishments on the 31st March 2009 was 30.99 lakh, as against 31.12 lakh on 31st March 2008. This decrease may be attributed to various recruitment policies of the government. Major factor behind this decline has been downsizing and right-sizing policy of the government. The percentage of women in the total employment has almost been static around 10% in the last 5-6 years. As per the statistics in 2009 and 10, 2.9 crore people were employed in organized sectors, whereas 43.7 crore people were employed in unorganized sector. Apart from these, there are large number of people who are self-employed, like plumbers, electricians, carpenters, beauticians, tutors, architects, freelance photographers, doctors, lawyers, etc. The self-employed people rely on their personal contacts for their business. Another way of recruiting people for work is through contractors or called as jobbers. For instance, in Kanpur textile mills, these jobbers are also called as mistris. They themselves are workers, but because they are close to the owner, they dominate over the other workers. They come from the same region and communities as the workers. These mistris also represent the workers. But as companies now employ people themselves and job search has become more free, gradually the importance of jobbers is declining in the industry. Many factories employ badli workers who substitute for the regular permanent workers who go on leave. Large number of these badli workers have actually worked for the same industry for many years, but they are not given the same status and job security. This is what is called as contract work in the organized sector. To conclude, let us summarize what we discussed today. We started our discussion with work and organizations in industrial societies. We discussed features of bureaucracy in detail as given by Max Weber. We also discussed the differences between jobs in the government and private sector and their comparative advantages and disadvantages. And finally, we discussed about the self-employed people, contract workers, and the badli workers. In the next part of this chapter, we'll discuss about the nature and problems in working conditions and trade unions. Till then, you can enjoy reading this part of the chapter. Thank you.